And Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte clash over the COVID situation in her city.
And Benjamin Netanyahu's term as Israel Prime Minister ends after more than a decade.
Good evening, I'm Tony Velasquez.
And I'm Karen Davila. Metro Manila mayors have agreed to shorten curfew hours starting tomorrow, June 15, to spur economic activity from 10 p.m. to 4 in the morning. The curfew will now begin at midnight until 4 a.m. Officials say the decision was based on improving COVID-19 figures in Metro Manila.
Ito'y base no, sa daily attack rate na 6.76 at ang two-week growth rate na negative 16.5. This will give more time sa mga taong kakain sa restaurants, sa mga malls na magbukas, may travel time at siguro makatulong ng gusto na sa ating ekonomiya.
The Philippines has so far hit barely 3% of its COVID vaccination target as delays mar the distribution of its newly delivered vaccine supplies. Despite this, Malacanang stands by its claim that the Philippines' COVID vaccination program is doing much better than that of its Southeast Asian neighbors. Vivian Gulia reports.
On Monday, around 8,000 Marikina residents received their first dose of Sinovac's COVID vaccine after the National Task Force Against COVID-19 green-lighted the use of a portion of Sinovac's second dose stocks as first doses. But the distribution of 1 million Sinovac COVID vaccine doses that arrived Thursday morning is still on hold as the government waits for a certificate of analysis from the manufacturer. Over the weekend, the government has started deploying to LGUs the nearly 2.3 million donated Pfizer COVID vaccine doses that arrived in the Philippines last week.
Ang sukatan natin doon ay yung kanilang ability to store and to handle dahil nga minus 80 degrees. No? Marami dyan ay sa mga malalaking syudad tulad ng NCR, ng Cebu at Davao. Pero nagpakita na rin ng capability ang mga ibang syudad sa Central Luzon, sa Southern Luzon, sa Region 6 at sa iba pang mga cities sa Mindanao.
Navota City received Sunday 7,020 Pfizer doses but it has yet to begin the rollout.
Hindi naman po namin magamit kasi wala po yung dilutant saka wala po yung siringgilya. So iniintay po namin siyang dumating para magamit po namin yung Pfizer.
As for the around 2.5 million AstraZeneca COVID vaccine doses scheduled to expire end of June and July, the Department of Health says almost all have been administered.
2.4 million has been given already, na-inoculate na, na-ibakuna na sa ating mga kababayan. So we are looking at around 100 plus thousand na lang na kailangan natin maibakuna para sa ating mga kababayan. So we have reached our target already.
After almost 3.5 months of COVID vaccination, close to 1.9 million Filipinos, or only 2.7% of the target 70 million, have been fully vaccinated, while over 5 million received the first dose. Malacanang denies misleading the public into thinking that the Philippines' COVID-19 vaccination drive is faring better than its Southeast Asian neighbors. It has repeatedly claimed the Philippines ranks second among Southeast Asian countries in terms of the number of COVID vaccines administered. But the independent Our World Data Tracker by the prestigious University of Oxford showed the Philippines ranked 9th out of 11 Southeast Asian nations in terms of the percentage of population vaccinated.
It's just two ways of looking at the numbers. One is absolute numbers and we remain second. There is no deception. And another is a percentage number which depends on your population. Natural, 50% ang Singapore. Eh, ilan lang naman ang Singapore? Wala pa ata silang 4 million. There's absolutely no deception when you use absolute numbers. Katotohanan lang po.
The Philippines expects to receive a total of around 11 million COVID vaccine doses this June, including 2 million more AstraZeneca doses from the COVAX facility. As more jabs from COVAX arrive in the Philippines, the country expects to begin this June the inoculation of indigent population or priority group A5.
Pagdating ng mga bakunang pagdating na rin ngayong June and July, makikita po talaga natin na tataas na tataas itong mga numero natin. Hopefully, aabot na tayo dun sa target natin na 500,000 and then tuloy-tuloy na po yan until we reach our target for 2021.
Vivian Gulia, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Senate will convene as a committee of the whole on Tuesday to discuss whether it would allot more funds for the government's COVID vaccination program. Senator Panfilo Lacson says the budget department has asked lawmakers for another 25 billion pesos for the purchase of vaccines with no clear accounting of how the previously allotted 82.5 billion pesos was spent.
We want a full accounting of the 82.5. Uh-oh. Second question, how much of the 82.5 came from borrowings? Kasi we keep borrowing using the vaccination program as the justification to borrow. It depends on their presentation. If the 82.5 billion has already been obligated and we see that we still lack vaccines to accomplish the herd immunity, then we might give it to them.
The executive department, meanwhile, welcomes the call for transparency and said Vaccines Czar Carlito Galvez will disclose details allowed by the confidentiality agreements with manufacturers.
Philippine health officials stress the need for quicker detection of COVID infections as cases of the disease spike in the Visayas region. Cebu province in particular is ordered by President Duterte to abide by the national government's COVID testing protocols for inbound travelers. Rafael Busano has this report.
The Philippine Health Department reported 6,426 new COVID-19 cases Monday, the lowest number of fresh cases in 4 days. 57 more patients have died, the lowest in nearly 2 weeks. But the Philippine College of Physicians says it's not the time to be complacent.
Sa ngayon, although medyo mas konti po siya kesa kumpara mo doon sa mga kaso nung March or April, no? But medyo madami-dami pa rin po yung mga pasyente po natin na nakikita, lalong-lalo na po doon sa ICU, no?
Meanwhile, independent research group OCTA sounds the alarm over the spike in the COVID-19 growth rate in Dumaguete, Negros Oriental, calling it area of most concern outside NCR Plus, with a 129% one-week growth rate and an average daily rate of 69.85%. Dumaguete Mayor Felipe Remolio says one of the reasons why COVID-19 cases spiked in their area is because of residents who came home from Metro Manila.
We are really appealing to the national authorities na dagdagan pa yung vaccine. Mm-hmm. Kami ready kami. I mean, in fact, mga private doctors already are volunteering to do the vaccines themselves. Full force kami, even private doctors and nurses sumasama sa vaccination.
The Department of Health in Region 6 confirmed that region is now high risk. Based on the latest case bulletin, Bacolod City has recorded the most cases, followed by Iloilo Province, Negros Occidental, Aklan, Capiz, Antique, and Guimaras. The Municipal Hall of Alimudyan in Iloilo has also been placed on lockdown after 3 employees tested positive for the virus. Alimudyan has 56 active cases of the disease. The DOH continues to call on local governments to institute measures that would cut the number of days between the detection of the virus in a person and his or her isolation. Health spokesperson Maria Rosario Vergara says throughout the country, it takes over 6 days between a person is detected for the virus and is subsequently isolated. In the NCR, it's longer at more than a week.
Ang ating target, base dun sa estimates ng ating mga eksperto, ay about 5.5 days pa lang ay makakapagbawas na tayo at least one-third of the cases. So kung may improve pa natin itong 7 and 6 days na tinitignan natin sa ngayon, mas ma-break natin ang chain of transmission.
While the target is to cut it down to 5 days, it would still be best to further shorten it between 24 to 48 hours to be able to cut the chains of transmission drastically. Meanwhile, the president has ordered the provincial government of Cebu to implement the interagency task force's testing protocols for inbound travelers. Cebu tests passengers upon arrival in the airport, while the IATF requires this screening on the 7th day of travelers' quarantine. The diversion to the Ninoy Aquino International Airport in Manila of flights bound for Mactan lapsed last June 12th.
The last extension was just a preparation for full implementation of that decision. So the president has also considered the DOH critique and has decided that Cebu province must abide with the IATF arrival protocols.
Cebu Governor Gwen Garcia earlier met with President Duterte to make their case for the province's custom protocols. Rafael Bosano, ABS-CBN News.
Philippine President Duterte puts on hold once again his decision to abrogate the country's visiting forces agreement with the United States. Philippine Foreign Affairs Secretary Teodoro Locsin Jr. says Duterte has suspended the abrogation by another 6 months. Duterte's order comes as both sides address his concerns over specific aspects of the security agreement. Locsin did not provide further details. This is the third time Duterte has suspended the VFA's abrogation since he ordered its unilateral termination in February last year. The deal allows American troops to be stationed on a rotational basis in the Philippines.
A simple misstep. That's how Malacanang describes President Duterte's loss of balance during an Independence Day ceremony in Bulacan Saturday. A video which showed the president almost falling while stepping up a podium quickly fueled concerns about his health. But palace spokesman Harry Roque says there was nothing to worry about.
It was a simple misstep. Malinaw naman po sa video, no, that the president was turning on a podium, no, some kind of a podium. So medyo na out of balance lang po. Wala naman pong problema sa kalusugan.
The president in various instances has disclosed his struggle with back pains, migraines, and Berger's disease, which affects blood vessels.
A squabble breaks out between two of the Philippines' potential rivals for the presidency next year. Vice President Lenny Robredo drew the ire of Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte after describing Davao's COVID surge as alarming. Robredo said Davao could even learn from Cebu City on how to manage the spike. Mayor Duterte accused Robredo of politicking. She says the proper time to attack her performance as a local chief executive is when Robredo dares to run for president. Malacanang doubled down on Mayor Duterte's remarks.
We fully support the statement of Mayor Sara in this regard. Tigil na muna ni BP Lenny ang pamumulitika. At sasagot naman po si Mayor Sara as Mayor of Davao City kapag daw po the VP quote dares to run for president. So abangan po natin ang enkwentro ng dalawa.
Robredo's camp, meanwhile, denies that she is politicking. Her spokesperson, Attorney Barry Gutierrez, says the vice president is willing to help Davao City unless her assistance gets politicized again.
Pro-democracy coalition Isambayan reveals its campaign app was hacked last week. One of the group's co-conveners, Attorney Howie Calleja, says the Isama Ako app for its supporters and volunteers was hit by a data breach on Saturday. That's the same day that the group released its nominees for the country's top posts. Isambayan believes the attack was orchestrated by its political rivals.
We have our safeguards, but obviously it was a professional hack. Hindi manglayong gawin niyan. At sabi ko nga, they have all the resources or all the logistics para gawin ito, itong dirty politics.
A group of residents of the Metro Manila city of Muntinlupa are protesting a move by the Bureau of Corrections to erect a new wall inside the new Bilibid prison compound. They say the 4-foot-high wall is inconveniences 2,000 families since it blocks an access road that leads to the city proper. Muntinlupa Representative Rufy Biazon slammed the Corrections Bureau for erecting the wall without coordinating with the local government. But the Bureau insists it does not need to coordinate with local officials for the project. It claims the wall will address security concerns in the area. Back in March, the Corrections Bureau built a wall which also blocked a road that residents used to go to the city.
The Philippine Education Department called out for a horrifying error in a student's module. During a house hearing, educator Antonio Calipogo showed a copy of the module which described an aswang or a ghoul in Filipino folklore as a creature looking for sex at night. It even used the vulgar Filipino word for sexual intercourse. The learning material was used by grade 10 students in Central Luzon.
Ito ay module na gawa ng DepEd Division Office somewhere and then ginamit ng bata. Pero the module itself contains a word na hindi ko pa nakikita anywhere.
The Education Department took responsibility for the error.
Ano pong nangyari? Ang dami ng titingin, hindi man lang nasilip ito. Napaka-glaring kasi. Imposible mo overlook mo.
Talaga pong hindi po katanggap-tanggap ito pong material na ipinakita po ni Ginoong Calipogo. Noong February 2021, kaagad-agad po itong nirecall ng division. Meron na po kami ginagawa internally para po panagutin yung dapat pong managot.
DepEd also says it has found more than 150 errors in its learning materials since October last year.
Coming up, China lashes out at G7 leaders for its united front against Beijing.
And two Americans face jail time for helping former Nissan chairman Carlos Ghosn flee Japan. The World Tonight returns after the break.
On the World Tonight, G7 leaders vow to show a united front to compete with China. The group's final communique at the close of their summit in England offers developing nations an infrastructure plan to rival that of China's Belt and Road Initiative. It also slammed China for its human rights abuses in its Xinjiang region. The G7 leaders called for a higher degree of autonomy for Hong Kong. They also demanded a thorough probe into the origins of the coronavirus. China's embassy in London denounced the G7 statement. It said it resolutely opposed the group's mentions of Xinjiang, Hong Kong, and Taiwan that supposedly distorted facts and exposed what it called the sinister intentions of a few countries such as the United States. The Chinese embassy also called for global unity in fighting the COVID pandemic rather than engaging in politicking.
I think we're in a contest, not with China per se, but a context with autocrats, autocratic governments around the world, as whether or not democracies can compete with them in the rapidly changing 21st century. And I think how we act and whether we pull together as democracies is going to determine whether our grandkids look back 15 years from now and say, did they step up? Are democracies as relevant and as powerful as they have been?
China is also on the agenda of the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, or the NATO summit, in Brussels in Belgium. Among those present, U.S. President Joe Biden, who is attending the event for the first time as America's leader. NATO leaders are expected to brand China a security risk to the Western alliance, citing Chinese investments in European ports and joint military exercises with Russia, among others. But British Prime Minister Boris Johnson made this clarification.
But I think when it comes to China, you've got to, I don't think anybody around the table today wants to descend into a new Cold War with China. I don't think that's where people are, but I think people see, they see challenges. They see things that we have to manage together.
Benjamin Netanyahu is unseated as Israel's prime minister, a post he's held for 12 years. The Israeli parliament approved a new government with a razor-thin 60-59 vote. The new leadership of nationalist Naftali Bennett is made up of a coalition of left-wing, centrist, right-wing, and Arab parties. Bennett vows to heal the rift among Israelis. But he won't be staying in power for long, as he will be replaced by centrist Yair Lapid as prime minister in 2023 under a coalition deal. Netanyahu, meanwhile, is not going down without a fight. Israel's longest-serving leader vowed to topple the new government and return to power soon.
Millions of vaccines made by Johnson & Johnson discarded in South Africa, while thousands of Pfizer vaccines are also wasted in Japan. This report.
South Africa's health product regulator will not allow the use of a batch of unqualified Janssen COVID-19 vaccine made by Johnson & Johnson. The agency cites data provided by the U.S. Food and Drug Administration, which revealed that batches of the Janssen vaccine produced at a U.S. plant were unsuitable for use. 2 million vaccine doses will be affected by the decision. Japan discards more than 6,000 doses of Pfizer vaccines, this after a cold storage unit in Tokyo's neighboring city of Kawasaki had what authorities call a temperature failure. The temperature to keep Pfizer vaccines should be between minus 80 to minus 60 degrees Celsius, but the temperature went up to 8 to 9 degrees Celsius. It's still not clear why the temperature went up. 6 more regions in Italy are now considered white zones, the lowest risk category in Italy's color-coded COVID restrictions. This means health restrictions are relaxed and the evening curfew has been lifted. Among them, the Lazio region, which includes the capital Rome, and Lombardy, which includes Milan. Mask wearing is still mandatory, as well as physical distancing. To be classified as white zone, a region must have registered fewer than 50 COVID cases per 100,000 inhabitants for 3 consecutive weeks.
2 Americans could face up to 3 years in prison after admitting they helped former Nissan boss Carlos Ghosn escape from Japan in 2019. Here's the full story.
An American father and son pleaded guilty in Tokyo on Monday to charges that they illegally helped former Nissan chief Carlos Ghosn flee Japan more than a year ago. U.S. Army Special Forces veteran Michael Taylor and his son Peter could now face up to 3 years in prison. Buses believed to be carrying the two were seen arriving in court on Monday. Prosecutors accused them of helping Ghosn escape Japan in a box aboard a private jet to Lebanon in December 2019. The pair allegedly received $1.3 million for their services. In March, they were extradited to Japan from the United States. That's after a months-long battle to prevent that by their American lawyers. Those lawyers argued that the two could face relentless interrogations and torture. Suspects in Japan are interrogated without their lawyers present and are often denied bail before trial. Japan's conviction rate is 99%. Taylor and his son are now being held at the same jail in Tokyo, where Ghosn was previously detained.
But obviously...
At the time of Ghosn's escape, he was awaiting trial on charges that he understated his compensation in Nissan's financial statements by $85 million over the course of a decade. He was also accused of enriching himself at his employer's expense through payments to car dealerships. Ghosn has repeatedly denied any wrongdoing. He remains a fugitive in his childhood home in Lebanon, which has no extradition treaty with Japan.
The House Committee on Ways and Means has approved a bill that would allow private schools to avail of the 10% preferential rate on taxable income granted to nonprofit schools. Committee Chair Albay Representative Joey Salceda says the measure is meant to intervene in the implementation of the Bureau of Internal Revenue's new rule, which increases the tax rate of private schools to 25%. He adds private schools can avail of the tax relief rate of 1% from July 2020 to June 2023 under the recently signed CREATE law. Private schools earlier warned of tuition hikes if the government slaps them with higher taxes.
Philippine shares inch up for a second straight session as the country's central bank chief remains upbeat about economic recovery prospects. Michelle Ong reports.
Philippine shares wavered all session but managed to end up Monday, extending 3 weeks of gains. China-backed securities Rustin Mercado says he's not surprised by the rally and even sees more upside.
Broader markets, EMs have actually rallied over the past few weeks as well. Trading volumes that give credence to the rally. So we've seen that those trading volumes come in. Foreigners have also started flowing back into the market, being net buyers. 3 to 6 months, we probably might reach 7.3, but then again, markets will, or investors will start focusing on prospects for 2022. Over the short term, 7,000 to 7,100 might be the short-term resistance, so we might see some consolidation after hitting those levels. There are signs that the rally is peaking over the short term, so profit-taking has picked up last week as trading volumes and downtick days have edged higher. So fund rotation to second and third liners have also picked up, which is usually indicative of a possible slowdown in the ascent of most index issues.
For the day, the PSE index added 10 points to close at 69.17. A lot of the recovery hopes are now hinged on the ramp-up in vaccination, especially in the National Capital Region. Central Bank Governor Ben Jokno also not worried that the rising number of cases in the provinces will cause another downgrade in economic projections.
The bulk of the GDP is in Metro Manila plus regions 4 and 3. They account for about around 66% of our economy. Very optimistic that we'll meet our target of at least maybe around 50 million by the end of the third quarter.
In corporate stories, fiber broadband provider Converge ICT is optimistic its inclusion in the FTSE Renaissance IPO Index and the FTSE ASEAN All-Share Index will attract more passive and active investors who monitor these FTSE indices. FTSE Russell is a unit of the London Stock Exchange. Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
Our final word tonight is a quote from Susie Kasem. When picking a leader, choose a peacemaker, one who unites, not divides.
And that is The World Tonight, the 14th of June, 2021. I'm Karen Davila.
I'm Tony Velasquez from the Philippines. Thank you. Mabuhay.